Hi, is my mic turned on? No? You can't hear what I'm asking? No? Okay. Let me ask this question. Okay, how many people are still only here right now because Stephen Colbert is in like 2 hours? You can raise your hand. But at least I got a little bit of a Colbert bump. Now my life is complete. The people who know Stephen Colbert know what I'm talking about. Let me also give a disclaimer. It's like we've been working on the Syrian Electronic Army attacks and got called in because, you know, we specialize in security awareness and people try to call the technology companies to like respond to these attacks and stuff. And in general, there is no technology to worry about. These are all like, I guess you'd consider it low-tech attacks. And when I proposed the session to RSA, it was my intent to do it by myself, well, not by myself, but with my business partner, Samantha. Samantha, where are you? Okay. Well, she's hiding. Oh, there she is. Everybody, now, Samantha is currently hungover, so I want everybody to say a nice, loud, hi, Samantha. One, two. Okay. So anyway, that's Samantha. Wow, I need a clicker. Anyway. But no, the evil people at RSA, when I said, hey, how about this session, and then I submitted it, then they said, oh, here's your presentation. Then they said, okay. Then I said, okay, well, Samantha's doing it with me. They're like, no, she's not. You never said it was. But anyway, it's their fault. So everybody say, bad RSA. One, two, three. Bad RSA. Okay. And we're not boycotting. We're just saying they're bad for not letting Samantha in. So anyway, with all that being said, so this talks about the Syrian Electronic Army, and it's like, wow, I got to, oh, this is a weird place to stand. If I fall off, it'll at least be entertaining. So, okay, so here's the deal. So when we started investigating these attacks, it was kind of interesting, because these are like, you know, low-tech spear phishing, but they're, for lack of a better term, really, really effective. These are really stupid attacks. I mean, it's kind of like I was investigating like a multi-million-dollar bank robbery, and in the process of doing this, you know, you find like if you think there's one break-in at a bank, there's really a dozen others that nobody knew about. So you find the dozen others, and we found this guy who broke into an electronic funds transfer system, EFT system, and he set up a wares site on the system. And it was like bizarre, because here's a guy who could have theoretically stole millions of dollars. He didn't even realize what he broke into. And that's probably part of the problem with the Syrian Electronic Army attack. These people could be doing a lot more damage if they ever got a clue. But in the meantime, let's talk about the whole thing, because I think I've already eaten up about half my 20 minutes. So anyway, let's talk, the Syrian Electronic Army, what are their origins and stuff like that? Initially, they grew out of potential, they first emerged on Facebook about April 2011. They started like kind of spamming pages and stuff like that. They registered a website. Like they would go to President Obama's pages and just as regular Facebook users say, you know, Syrian blood is on Obama's hands. And then, of course, Oprah was somehow involved. So, of course, Syrian blood is on Oprah's hands. So pretty much all they did was they started publicly defacing using just regular open accounts and stuff like that, just adding to popular Facebook pages. But after a while, they opened up their Twitter account, and then they began to deface websites, primarily from Syrian dissidents and stuff like that. But that was kind of how they got their initial start. Then they began spamming Facebook pages, of course, the diabolical Oprah, like I mentioned before. And then they started going ahead and defacing web pages, like where they would actually do some hacking of web pages and do stuff like that. And then they use Facebook, like they would open up different accounts on Facebook because Facebook would close them down. But they actually started taking polls, like, where should we deface websites? I mean, it's kind of like, not the brightest people in the world. The attacks were really low tech. Again, pretty much doing things. And everybody started thinking, wow, they call themselves a Syrian Electronic Army. And they started drawing equivalents from the Iranian cyber army, if you know who they are. They actually did some real major defacements. And the Iranian cyber army are really, really smart technical people and stuff like that and do some real work. But everybody was equating them with, you know, Iran and stuff. But it wasn't really the case. But ironically, though, even though the attacks weren't highly sophisticated, they weren't highly technical, they did start growing in sophistication in how they were accomplished. And I'm going to talk through one or two of the case studies there. Okay, so a lot of people want to know who's behind the Syrian Electronic Army. Initially, If you look at the web domains and things like that, it comes out of the Syrian Computer Society. Like, you know, they have the same server or same registrar or whatever it was, which was President al-Assad. Bashar al-Assad was like the founder of it. I really don't think he found it. I don't think he's that smart. But the reality is that, you know, he was like president in name only of this society. They claim to be nice, loyal 20-something Syrians. And they're so smart that you can actually figure out their names. I have their names up because two different sources have it. I spoke to Brian Krebs, who outed them previously. But yeah, this guy Hatim Deeb is like pretty much named the leader. And it's kind of bizarre because, you know, he registered as the admin of the Syrian Electronic Army website. And then when he went back, you know, like a few, when people said, hey, you registered the, he's like, would I be that stupid to actually use my own name when I originally registered? Yeah, he would be that stupid. So anyway, you got him. Supposedly, he might have moved to Russia. Then you have a Mohammed Osman, who is like another one of the people that's been credited for being a member of the Syrian Electronic Army. And he is listed as a front-end developer of a website design firm. And it seems like he moved to Turkey, from what intelligence gatherers seem to say, and now has his own web design company. So again, these are like not necessarily computer illiterate, but not necessarily like, you know, programming like supercomputers or anything like that. As far as who's really behind it, you know, at the end of the day, does it really matter? I mean, honestly, these people are kind of like the cockroaches of the internet at the moment. There's really no way around it. But, you know, the reality is a lot of people say Syrian intelligence is behind them. It's like if Syrian intelligence is behind it, they don't have very intelligent intelligence people. That's all I could say. Because they're not really gathering data. You know, and then we'll talk about what they actually do. The attacks are really of little consequence except to spread propaganda. I mean, seriously, how many people hack The Onion and think they're making a political statement? I mean, the only reason you hack The Onion is to show you're politically clueless, to tell you the truth. What they say, though, is that this guy, Rami Mak, is anybody here Arabic that knows how to pronounce his name? Well, actually, he doesn't deserve to have his name pronounced right anyway, so it doesn't matter. But anyway, supposedly he's a cousin of Bashar al-Assad, and he's been paying people $500 to $1,000 per successful defacement, hack, whatever. There's talk of support from Russia, but at the end of the day, does it really matter? I mean, I think even Russia has better things to do than what these imbeciles are doing. Okay, so now, notable Syrian Electronic Army attacks. I mean, you could see the list. They started off, again, Harvard University, the bastion of computer security, whatever. So then, the first real international one was they hacked the Qatar Foundation, because Qatar, whatever you call it. They've been primarily hacking the social media accounts of different people. Sometimes there's been redirects, but when you look at what they've actually done, most of these things have been hacks of the Twitter and other accounts. So, for example, the Forbes account, they theoretically hacked into Forbes most recently, and from Forbes they went ahead and got into the databases and things like that. But really, they didn't hack into it, they just, you know, pretty much spearfished people, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. Also, you know, and these is like especially for the Europeans, they hacked the diabolical Barcelona football team's Twitter account. So that really made an impact in the world events. You know, again, all they did was use these accounts for defacement, but still they had access to a lot of these accounts. The apparent damage, though, really the only major damage that ever seemed to have resulted from this was when they hacked the AP Twitter account, not AP itself, just the Twitter account. And they put out an explosion that put out a tweet that basically said there was an explosion at the White House and President Obama was injured, and that sent Wall Street into a Twitter, you know, or Twitter, whatever the word is. So that was really the only major thing that ever happened as a result of the Syrian Electronic Army attacks. The reality is that primarily it's embarrassment for people. They are potentially leaking customer information. They are gathering a lot more information than you would ever think they are, because they don't, you know, they don't really release it because it's so inconsequential. And most of the time, I'm guessing they don't even know what they have, you know, because primarily they're just out there using different accounts to deface things. But they really do have access to a lot of information. How many people have ever been hit by them? Well, yeah, nobody's going to raise their hand, let's face it. Okay, so one of the things that's a problem is when the FBI, you know, like companies realize they've been hit. And then a couple weeks later, the FBI says, I'd like to give you some information. I'm not going to tell you how I have it, but we have information to believe the following email accounts have been compromised. And then you're like, oh, sorry, I can't curse, but how about no crap, Sherlock? And then all of a sudden, so they give you this list of accounts and information, and then it's like most of the time the companies already know about it, but the FBI is out there looking at different websites, apparently, looking at online chat boards and seeing the information that they exchange privately. So there is some information that they capture that's not being made public, because frankly, most people really don't care about it. But you know, again, at the most part, it's really just embarrassing. Attack methodology. The most embarrassing methodologies they tend to have are to attack DNS services. How many people heard about like the account a couple weeks, or the attack, quote unquote, a couple weeks ago, where they essentially hacked into a web provider or a DNS provider, and it said, we could have changed the Facebook DNS service or something like that? Because what they did was they hacked the registrar, but luckily, following good practices, Facebook had their domain locked. So the Syrian Electronic Army could not go ahead and change it without going through steps that would have required actual Facebook interaction. So what happens is these people break into registrars to attempt to change the DNS addresses. That's their primary. When you hear of a website being defaced, most of the time they have never touched the website itself. They've pretty much just redirected the DNS for the website. They target individuals inside the targeted organizations. Again, like I mentioned before, they send out a lot of spear phishing messages and things like that. They primarily and predominantly try to target social media accounts. They're looking for people who have access to the Twitter logins. They're looking for people who have access to Facebook logins and a variety of other types of social networking things. Because really what they want to do is, 9 times out of 10, unless it's a very, very highly trafficked website, they really just want to go ahead and send out tweets and posts to millions of people. And by what they're doing is they're targeting the people who have access to those accounts. Now remember, sometimes, how many people know what Hootsuite is and stuff like that? You know, where you can like have one interface to many, many accounts? The Syrian Electronic Army is really targeting a lot of those accounts or people who have access to those type of master accounts. And then those type of services, because there are several commercial services that provide a single portal into social media sites. And those people are also highly targeted by the Syrian Electronic Army. So again, they focus on, again, the social media accounts more than the organization itself. Let's talk about the New York Times hack a little bit. And again, this wasn't just the New York Times hack. It really was the Huffington Post hack. It was the Twitter hack and a variety of other things. Because what they essentially did, and this shows how pervasive they are. I don't want to say advanced or sophisticated. It just shows pretty much how pervasive they are in their attacks. When they come across a target, and they think New York Times, Huffington Post, they figured out that the Melbourne IT was the provider, DNS provider, for all these major international media outlets. And what they did was they say, we want to go ahead and get access to the admin panel so we can reset the DNS address for these people. And what they did was they researched Melbourne IT. They weren't able to access Melbourne IT directly, but they realized that Melbourne IT has people who resell Melbourne IT services and have access to set up accounts and to change accounts for their customers. So what they did was they researched a wide variety of resellers for Melbourne IT. They came across one in New Zealand, ironically, and they went ahead and sent spear phishing messages to the account holders in New Zealand. And once they had the account holders in New Zealand, they got their logon credentials. They went ahead and reused the logon credentials on Melbourne IT. And then were able to reset via the administrative panel. They were able to reset the DNS addresses for the New York Times, Twitter, Huffington Post, etc. Now, that was kind of a hack of three organizations deep, but it was really just the case of spear phishing. And it was a case, again, of not people not locking their domains, which is a fundamental and basic thing. How much time do I have? Wow, it took me longer to get an answer than to get what it would have been. Okay, So anyway, like I mentioned before, targeted spear phishing attacks. I don't know how. I thought that would look so much more legible when I put it up there. But anyway, this is an actual example of the spear phishing message that they sent to CNN. They basically went ahead and asked people to reset their Outlook account. And what they do is they ask people to, like, you know, send it to CNN employees. And it's not really hard, because what they're going to do is they go ahead and research LinkedIn. They go ahead and research a lot of other people, figure out who works in the targeted organizations, and send them spear phishing messages. They also research, and it's not really hard. They figure out what type of email, of webmail interface they might use, and they target that and create a webmail interface that looks identical to what it would normally look like, whether they're using Gmail, Outlook, whatever. They go ahead and have an interface that looks like that, send a spear phishing message, person clicks on it, and then goes ahead and is asked to reset the account. And this, in this case, if you actually read it, I can't even read it myself, but basically it says you have to update your Microsoft Outlook account, and it go ahead and it, like, you know, brings up something that looks exactly like the Microsoft webmail page, and, you know, asks to change, and then they ask to have to, you know, enter their user ID and password, and then they go ahead and reset it and have access to the accounts. And then they go ahead and what I'll talk about later is they try to reuse the password on the social networking accounts if the people are relevant. Again, more targeted. Mostly, they appear to be from company officials. When we've done investigations on there, it looks like, you know, they know who the CEO is. They know who the employees are. They go through LinkedIn and other places, and they send a message out from the CEO saying, look at this news story about us in the Wall Street Journal. Some of them are even sophisticated enough. One we looked at, there was a guy who was working for a U.S. company who happened to be British, and they sent him a message from that appeared to be from their European manager and said, here's an article about us in the BBC. And only he got that message from the BBC, supposedly from the BBC. So they do a lot of research and do a lot of targeting to figure out who the people are. And it's not that hard to figure out how to go ahead and better tailor it. Anyway, after the initial success, they pretty much let reporters know in advance. If you follow the Syrian Electronic Army on Twitter, they have two reporters as their bitches. Sorry, I have to say, I mean, these people are interacting. Give me details. It's like, oh, please, let me be your press. These people are acting more as their PR agent than reporters. And they go ahead, they give them articles, and once they give them articles, they then get them to write articles in advance, so then they send the links to the companies with more spear phishing messages. So what happens is they send them the link says, oh, to access this, please enter your company's user ID and password and log on, and then that's another way they do it. So they log in, get access, and then they get more. And then once inside, they look for email lists. So once they get access to, assuming your account, they see if you're on an internal corporate email list, and then they send messages out as you to other people inside the company, trying to get more people to go to the web, you know, access pages, login pages, and get more credentials. Then if you have something like Google Apps, they go on your system. I know you're going to put that down. Anyway. So they go ahead, they get access to all the information in your files, like if you're using Google Apps, they'll be able to look at all your documents, spreadsheets, whatever, and go through those, they'll capture them, try to put them on online servers and stuff like that. Sometimes they'll change the passwords to lock people out. More frequently, they'll keep the passwords the same, but if it's like a social networking account they want to control, they'll change the password so that the people can't reset the password later. Most important, they look for password reuse on other accounts. So if they get your email password, they will assume that that might also be the company, the Twitter password that you use for the corporate account. And again, they search for login credentials at other accounts and use accounts for password resets. Okay, so prevention, because this is a talk about prevention. Lock your domains. Number one, first and foremost. If every attack we've seen, if people would lock their domains, much like what happened with the Facebook hack or attempted hack, that would prevent just about all DNS relocations. Also, something else, implement multi-factor authentication. I don't know, like, for example, a lot of people we've seen hack use Google Apps. Google allows for multi-factor authentication using the Google Authenticator or whatever else. If that would have happened, all those attacks would have been prevented. These are not high-tech attacks that are unstoppable. ensure the hover function is working and warns about potentially wrong links. You know, there's McAfee Site Advisor or Site Minder or whatever it is that you can install on corporate computers that give people red flags if links don't go to where they appear to be going. And there, you know, it's not just McAfee, but there's other functions like that. Proper awareness training on what to do. And also warn against mobile logins. We found that a lot of people that got hit by the Syrian Electronic Army attacks or fell victim, a lot of the people woke up in the morning and got on their mobile phones and they said, wow, there's an article about my company in the Wall Street Journal. They click on the link and it comes up on their like little iPhone and they don't know enough to like hover over like how you press the button and hold down to get what the actual address is. So a lot of people don't know that. So you got to make sure people have special training about remote access via mobile devices. And you might want to tell them, if you have a mobile device, watch out for that. Because a lot of the people hit by this are doing that through mobile devices. Anyway, detection, awareness. You know, awareness is about prevention. But a good awareness program, and one company we saw did it incredibly great. What happened was one person said, hey, I got this email. It looks wrong. They sent it to their security person. And within minutes, the security person sent it out to the whole organization. Within an hour, they figured out everybody who was successfully hit and locked out all account, well, locked out pretty much every account within an hour, letting people know who, that there's a potential attack going on, figuring out who was potentially compromised and did it. And that was all because users told them when things were going, when something didn't seem right. User alerts, and here's a problem with these type of things. You need to have an internal alert system that's not reliant upon email. Because if you're reliant upon email and they've compromised your email, they could screw things up. So it's good to have like an SMS alert system and stuff like that that you could get out, and that's another thing that could help stop it. Anyway, reaction. Force password resets immediately. If people don't have multi-factor authentication turned on, make sure they turn it on. Make sure they change their passwords, not just on their account, like the mail account that's being targeted, but make sure their social networking, their Twitter accounts and everything else, that the passwords are reset on that. Because you never know what's happened. Because we've seen a lot of companies where their emails, where they'll have their Twitter password in emails sitting in people's emails. And if you don't go ahead, and even if they think, oh, we don't have, they don't have our Twitter account because we don't reuse the password, too frequently people email those types of passwords. Attempt to block different domains, because the problem with the Syrian Electronic Army is you can, like, large companies have tried to shut down the malicious domains, but the problem is it's the devil you know is better than the devil you don't know. So like they've stopped asking domain administrators to shut down those domains. Instead, they try to blacklist the domains out of their website to prevent that. Look for sleeper accounts. A lot of times what they'll do is they'll hack some accounts. Once they get in, they'll try looking around. But they'll sit on other accounts that they've compromised, which is a big reason why password changes are important. Because they'll go back in after you think they're locked out. And then they'll go back in a few days later and start their whole activities again because they left some accounts sitting there so that they could go back and exploit those. Check all accounts for illicit logins. You know, go back in logs and see if anybody's trying to access them from Syria, from Cyprus, from anywhere but, you know, from anywhere where they shouldn't have been accessed from. And, you know, that's from log activity and also attempt to look activity for logged accounts. Okay, so now conclusions. She tells me to show everybody your sign. Okay? Anyway, it says stop. So anyway, the Syrian Electronic Army, they're not technologically advanced, but they are effective. That's the number one concern. Anyway, I'll just reiterate since I'm out of time, domain locking, multi-factor authentication, and make sure reaction assumes the worst, which means make sure you assume that they've compromised your email systems, which is very likely that they have. So anyway, with that, I'm sure you're supposed to all leave, but I'll be around for questions if you have any questions. Thanks so much.